seventh pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Any additions to the agenda?
None.
Motion to approve.
Motion and second, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Approve the minutes from the 1/5/21 meeting.
Second.
I got a motion and second, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign, motion carries. Public comment period, I see none, so we'll move on. Donna Grant?
Yep, Donna's online.
Oh, she's online.
Yep.
Donna, are you there?
I am. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
All right, I'm hopefully not going to echo too bad here. So I have a report for you from 2020. And I did email that out last night, so hopefully you did receive that, or you can pull it up in your email, or else look at it after a while. Can you hear me okay, Becky?
Yep, perfect. Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Ooh, good background, too.
That's our storm from last year, yes. Okay, so in the report, we did activate the emergency operations plan last year. So by activating the emergency operations plan, it assigns responsibilities to organizations and individuals. It basically opens up our powers within the county level. So it goes through chapter 12 within that chapter. It allows emergency management in the county to move forward when needed. So normally with the local declaration, the emergency management director coordinates the process with the county board chair and the administrator to ensure that the county meets our requirements and the needs of the county constituents. Last year, in 2020, we didn't really have a lot of time for preparedness, but we did work on, we had many tabletop exercises with FEMA and dealing with active threat. We also had a tabletop exercise at the West Central Research and Outreach Center. We had all of our emergency response partners included, our schools, public health, Minnesota Department of Health, and Homeland Security Emergency Management also participated. I included some photos of all of the work that we've done. And in the report, it does show planning for what we're going through right now, the pandemic. So public health did have pods or administrative tabletops and functional exercises, which they did practice on how they would vaccinate or immunize or whatever they would need to do. Working with Westland Village, working with Prairie Ridge, we had many exercises that we worked on last year and the year before. The FEMA Declaration 4442, which was the flooding of 2019, it continued into 2020. I'm expecting a follow-up report from Homeland Security, and I can share that with you when I receive that, to show the closeouts in which townships and cities participated in that and the amount brought back into the county for the losses of our roads, culverts, and also ditches, having to clean those out. I did share a few photos in there, preliminary damage assessment meetings and meetings with FEMA. We had good turnout, good representation from our county, and I think there was just one township that ended up backing out of that declaration. Our FEMA Declaration 4531 is the COVID-19 pandemic, which began around March for Stevens County of 2020. The declaration at the federal level was April 7th, 2020, and the incident period is continuing and is continuing through 2021. I also included a little a photo of phases of the disaster, and normally we look at 1 to 3 days which is the response side of it, and then we move into recovery. With the pandemic, we're looking at 1 to 3 years for this incident. So we'll be busy for quite a while. I also included SBA economic disaster loan information in there, which just shows if we're if we do not declare a disaster, we are still eligible in a way. So you'll see that Big Stone County was eligible for the SBA economic loans for farmers and ranchers. There were many, many other grants and loans available for our businesses, farmers, ranchers, and as we find those, Becky does post those on our county website. Emergency Operations Center, as I mentioned, was activated in March of 2020. I did include a map in your handout, which shows the counties that are currently activated as of last night. Those in red or orange are full activation. Those in yellow are partial activation. And if they show blue, there's no current activation in that county level. We did move from full activation to partial activation last year, and now we're back in full activation just because of the work that we're doing at the county level. And I also feel it's important to identify the work that the county is doing to support the incident. I work daily, and Becky works daily on supporting this incident, as the board, as you also do. So that's interesting to just see the different levels of the response. And then also the next page, it does show our EOC logistics. Many of you didn't have the opportunity to go into the EOC, but it was mostly for our logistical purposes of storing our PPE, the collection of donated items that we received, also the support and coordination between the two counties. I had both counties included in that, in the EOC. And then we also have in the handouts, public information media briefings. The county coordinated two media briefings in 2020, coordinating with SCMC and our public health, Horizon Public Health Administrator Ann Steen. We also worked on depopulation of animals, the concerns that our ag partners had, working closely with Department of Ag, USDA, and the state EOC. To help support them and at least notify the state of the problems that we were seeing out here at the local level. Also working with Mass Fatality Planning, updating our Mass Fatality Plan, working with Dr. Stock, who's the county coordinator, coroner, Peterson Funeral Home, Reggie Welly, and Sheriff Dingman. Hang up on that call I'm receiving, sorry about that. COVID-19 testing continues at the National Guard Armory. This week it will be Wednesday through Friday, and next week it will be Wednesday through Saturday. We're not sure what will happen after the 30th of this month, if it will continue or if it will end at that time. They are working on, we have a request into the state to utilize that location as possible a place to vaccinate individuals if we get to that point. So there will be more to come on that. We've been working with Horizon Public Health, our pharmacies and hospitals, to vaccinate our healthcare workers, assisted living, adult homes, EMS, first responders, law enforcement, fire, many, many, many groups. It's the first in line who have face-to-face contact with individuals. Our emergency services should be about 98% vaccinated for those who are interested anyway, and those who provide face-to-face services. You'll see the different phases in that handout. So you have 1A, 1B, and 1C. We will hear more today about this pilot project that's taking place in the state of Minnesota. That's kicking off today at noon for Minnesotans 65 years of age and older, and then also school, education, childcare workers. So we haven't received any other information than what I have on your handout that was shared on the counter and the MDH website. So I have a call with Marcia from Horizon Public Health and Bev from SCMC this morning, and also a call with the state EOC this afternoon, and I should be able to email or provide an update after that. There are specific locations for this pilot project that they're rolling out, and it's Anoka, Brooklyn Center, Fergus Falls, Marshall, Mountain Iron, North Mankato, Rochester, St. Cloud, and Thief River Falls. I have heard that it's limited doses. The state of Minnesota, what I've heard last week, is the state is still receiving around 60,000 doses of vaccine a week, which may sound like a lot, but it really is not when we have over 5 million people in the state. Well, there's more to come on that. I'll provide an email and update as soon as I know more about that. And then our COVID-19 confirmed cases, as of yesterday, Stevens County had 701 confirmed, and we continue to see the 8 deaths associated with COVID-19. We still have the Minnesota hotline at 800-657-3504. Anyone can call that number between 9 and 4 weekdays if you have questions about vaccine, if you have questions about testing, quarantine or isolation, you may call that number. I've heard that our hospitals, clinics, and public health have been overwhelmed with receiving calls about vaccine. And what we've heard is that as soon as there is vaccine available, the public will be notified. And we know that there is a great interest for those who are 65 and older to receive that vaccination. It continues to be a two-dose shot or two-dose series, and it will either be 21 or 28 days apart. And they're coordinating that second dose also. I did hear, that on, I think it was on Monday, yesterday, that SCMC has a wait list that they're collecting names, and I've heard that from other hospitals and clinics throughout the region, that they are taking names, or else they will at least notify their individuals that they work with when that vaccine is available. And to continue on page 7, weather events throughout Minnesota. We've seen high wind events, hail, blizzards in 2020. I have a few photos of what has happened in both counties. Our active 911, our response phase, the county does support this. And you will see that there were calls, and our dispatch in Stevens County is excellent at screening those calls. So you'll see I did screenshot a few of those so that you could see our ambulance services. They did receive many, many calls showing the need to use universal precautions, and that did help quite a bit for our emergency responders to know. So thank you for your support in monetary support in providing that active 911 app for our emergency responders. And also at the bottom of that page 7, you'll see that it was utilized for the bomb threat that was in Morris in January of 2020. And there's also within that app, you can see who was responding, who has responded, in the location of that responder. I'm still the administrator for that. Brian Kaler in dispatch, he helps with that. And we make sure that we double check who has access to that information. Our emergency alert system continues to decode red. We received an invoice now for this year. We're on the last year of that agreement with Code Red. Sheriff Dingman did approve 5 years, so we're moving into that fifth year now this year, and we'll relook at that expense cost and the services that we're receiving from that. Our GR level 3, I think we've paid, it's under $200 a year is what we pay for that subscription, and that allows our weather mapping in dispatch, and then also on the emergency management laptop that I carry with me. It provides up-to-date information. You can see if there's rotation in the clouds. You can see if there's hail. You can see that weather that's coming towards Stevens County. Over the last couple of years, we've seen about 140 warnings, watches, advisories from the National Weather Service, and those are also posted on Facebook. So we try to keep the public up to date on that. And then also there's many like KMRF, KKOK, they share those posts, Facebook posts and such. We also have our county tone alert system. You'll see that up on the slide there, that there are boxes located throughout the county and dispatch can share information over that box, whether there's a warning, a watch, and then also if there are other reasons that we need to warn the public to take cover or to respond in any way. Those are nursing homes, in our nursing home and assisted livings and those different facilities throughout the county. And then also in the county building. We also have our page to text system again. I have that set up in my office now instead of in dispatch until after the pandemic passes or wait safe to enter. You will also see that our emergency responders receive a text from that system. I enter those their cell phone numbers and their email addresses into the system, and then that will alert them by phone. So it's just a kind of a backup way of notifying in case a pager doesn't work. Or also if a fire chief is out of the county and can't receive that page, if they're not in that area, then they can at least know that there's something happening within the county. Our County Continuity of Operations Plan, our COOP, Becky sent out surveys to the department heads, and I sent out surveys to each city and some of our other essential services within the county who serve Stevens County. And we've been receiving those back in. Becky and I will work on those either this week or next week and create that critical services list for vaccinations and other things that we need to look at. And that will be provided to the board after we're finished with that. Also in 2020, Stevens County was one of the last to be able to provide in-person Skywarn training. And you'll see that Amanda and Nick Elms provided that training in two locations in Stevens County. It was in Hancock and in Morris for our emergency responders with a pretty good turnout. We also have our MnDOT511.org. If you haven't or don't check that out, that app out during weather, it's a great resource to look at closed roads, just different things like that. And that's for the general public. Anyone can go to MnDOT or 511.org. And then public preparedness we provide, which is required by the state. Emergency management provides information on Severe Weather Awareness Week, which is in April each year, and Winter Weather Awareness Week, which is in November each year. We still have our Facebook page and working closely with the posts for the Stevens County new Facebook page and share posts quite often on weather and warnings, just different things like that. Monitoring civil unrest. In the state, in the nation, there's a photo there of a vehicle that was burnt down in the cities during the civil unrest, and then also the flyer which shows if you see something, say something. So call 911 if you see something. That's unusual. We will be emailing out our emergency guide for our county employees. Sheriff Dingman has been looking through that, and we'll email that out this afternoon to our county employees. So they'll be able to refresh themselves. And then our hazard mitigation plan, you'll see this graph was provided by the state last week showing where Stevens County is at in the process for hazard mitigation updates. I think I've just completed the last survey and report form helped by Bill Kleindahl, Todd Larson, and many others throughout the county. Becky helped with that quite a bit also, coordinating information. And Matt Salmsas, many others assisted with the questions and in completing that information. So thank you to them. You'll see that we're right on track with the funding It's $6,250 is our match, and by all the work that everyone is providing throughout the county, I think we'll be okay with that. We will not have to pay that amount. It's in our in-kind, which we'll be able to meet that match. So October through December, it was $923.44. So we have $436.12 left to meet. So we should be good with that. Also, our floodplain, Bill Kleindel has been working hard with FEMA on updating that plan. I think it's been posted on the Stevens County Facebook page and throughout the county on that update. And we'll be working throughout the next year again on NFIP to make sure that each city has that resolution accepting that NFIP work. Our grant funding through 2020 was EMPG, EMPGS, which was the COVID-19 supplemental funding. And that continues now into 2021. We did not use that funding last year, looking at possibly using it this year. I'll work with Sheriff Dingman and Becky to identify areas that we may need to use that, but it'll probably end up going towards my time, my work time. We did also receive an ID badge printer. Still haven't had time to finalize the IDs for that yet. But that should be coming soon. And then also our CARES Act funding. Our ARMOR, Local System Administration, Sheriff Dingman and I work closely with that. We did have a router go out last year. The battery on the key loader, you'll see a photo of that there. And just some of this equipment. I've been working closely with Brian Kaler in dispatch, updating him on the different systems, and you'll see another photo of our dispatch console on there. You'll see many yellow triangles with exclamation points in, which show that something is not working and not right. So when dispatch does have a problem with how things are working, they'll notify Brian and I right away, and then I notify Sheriff Dingman. And if we need to update equipment, we have that Motorola agreement, which then provides that equipment usually free of charge to us because we pay that amount each year. You'll see the different groups that we continue to participate in, which are required for us to apply for grant funding through the region. So it's the owners and operators and user committee meetings. There are others that are not mentioned in this report, such as Justin Howe, Jason Reed, excuse me, and others. But Brian Kaler and I normally participate in the owners and operators, our RAC and lager meetings at Sheriff Dingman and I, and then Sheriff Dingman and I decide on the programming and administration for all of our radios in the county. We did have an agreement to complete the update on our code plugs and everything last year, and all of the reprogramming is just being finalized now, so we did not receive that invoice last year, but we should be receiving that soon. And I think we did budget around $10,000 for all of that work and to purchase radios. We did have the opportunity to use CARES Act funding for some of those radios, which saved quite a bit for costs for our constituents. So we do have the agreement with West Central Communications and Motorola and the West Central or the Central Minnesota Radio Group yet. And also Bob Kapitsky, and I think it's Jeannie Annan, is the alternate for that board. So thank you for that. Our trainings each year, I let you know, or I notify you of those trainings that are required. So it's FEMA, NIMS, ICS, Incident Command System 100, 200, and 700. I have the links provided in those in this handout, and it's also recommended that we all do those trainings at least every 3 years. So it's probably time for all of us to do that again. Also including psychological first aid information, the trainings that were offered virtually instead of in person. We're going to be holding the CARE, which is pipeline training, coming up in February. It'll be virtual training this year, and it will not be in person. Also, BNSF has provided virtual trainings this year, too. As I mentioned, the emergency response guide will be emailed out to all of you this afternoon. If you have any questions, you may contact Sheriff Dingman or myself. I appreciate all of your support and guidance and everything throughout this last year. We've put in many hours. I know Becky and I probably about the same. My regular hours were, I think, 2,157, 418 hours overtime. And it's just hopefully this year, 2021, is a little bit less busy and have a little bit of time for vacation and time with family. So I guess I can just say I continue to support public health, as we all should, to continue the mitigation efforts to wash your hands, distance from each other. We need to continue doing that. If you cannot wash your hands, use hand sanitizer when you get in your vehicle from being in a public place, and mask. It's still important to mask. Our vaccinations, the call that I have with public health this morning, Bev and Marcia and I will discuss the plans for this week and next week on who will be vaccinated. The vaccine coming in, as you have heard, there's still limited vaccine, so we're just ensuring that those second doses for those individuals who are vaccinated can still receive that second dose, so the first and second dose. So, and that is all that I have. Are there any questions?
So Donna, when they're doing the vaccinations, is it recommended to kind of stagger a facility's vaccination so they don't know? Because some people are saying they get sick after that second dose, so that you don't have all your staff sick at the same time.
Oh, yes. I figured out what you were saying. No, Jeannie, I couldn't hear you very well, but staggering staff. Yes, we have been staggering staff. The hospitals, everyone that's vaccinated, we do have a plan in place for that. So now by that staggering, our law enforcement emergency services also in the nursing staff, some are just receiving their second dose and some are receiving their first dose now. Yep, so that is the plan, and throughout the state or throughout the West Central region is what I've heard so far.
Okay. Okay.
Well, thank you, Donna. Anybody else have anything? Don't sound like it. So thanks for all you do for us.
Yep, thank you.
All right, we'll move on then. Liberty, come on up.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Mr. Wallers did review the warrants before today's meeting. The total is $161,423.55. Again, $161,423.55. A couple of those one-time fees or beginning of the year include caseworks, the Life Center, and Sourcewell, which made up a bulk of that above and beyond.
Motion to approve the pay the warrants in the amount of $161,423.55.
I'll second. Okay, a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Liberty, I had a question on one of the warrants. It's on page 2. It says 2019 audit difference.
Audit difference, on which date?
On the very top.
Yeah.
That's work comp for MCIT. They go back and do an adjustment.
Oh, okay.
We do an estimate when we pay work comp, and then they go back and audit it.
Okay.
I think we have received that bill from you directly.
Yeah.
With that difference.
Yep. Yeah, we pay based on an estimate, then they added it, and if they were wrong based on the audit, then we get charged back.
Okay.
I do have the Youth Activity and Safe Fund donations. They are listed in the issue summary. I'm recommending to approve the above donations for Youth Activity Fund and Senior Adult Funds for Emergencies.
Motion to approve the donations. I'll second.
Motion is second. Any more discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
And then at the beginning of the year, I do provide a holiday donation, which is separate than our youth activity and safe fund donations. And so those donations are issued, are listed in the issue summary. We do have a policy that we do like to have all of those donations out of our hand by the 1st of February. So we have very few of those items left and do distribute them around Thanksgiving and Christmas. And I'm recommending to approve the above holiday donations.
Motion to approve.
I'll second with a thanks to the community that has really stepped up this year.
I got a motion and second. I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Thank you. The Region 4 South Mental Health Consortium Joint Powers Board bylaws is the next agenda item. Commissioner Innan also sits on that board with myself. We had brought the bylaws maybe about a year and a half, 2 years ago as one county. There are two counties that are now provided by one director. And since then, now we have three counties that are being served by one director. And so the bylaws needed to be updated to meet that need. So each county would have a person at the table discussing the county needs from that perspective. So I am recommending approving the Region 4 South Mental Health Consortium bylaws.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Got a motion and second. Any discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
One thing we also added is that the five commissioners from those counties sat on the executive board, and now they're going to be part of the governing board, which meets monthly. So we're hoping that's going to be better engagement from all the counties as well. So
I did want to provide an update on Sourcewell. If you remember, they began managing the family child care licensing in July 1st of 2020. Currently, there are 19 active family child care licenses in Stephen County.
How many?
19. There continues to be a long-standing need for child care, especially infant care. Recently, 11 out of the 19 did complete an anonymous survey that was provided by Sourcewell. And I wanted to provide just the following trends. The average license length out of those 11 providers was 17 years, which is a lot of experience. 4.6 out of 5 stars were rating the licensor experience with Sourcewell, when 5 stars was the highest you could get. Some of the notations that were provided within the survey, they're easy to access, provide detailed information on a weekly basis, and have provided a strong support in regards to the current pandemic. So just wanted to provide an update to you guys as far as from the family child care licensors that did provide that survey. And then the last item is a human services update. Also just wanted to provide just an update and how the pandemic has influenced the way we're providing services and meeting those of the needs in the community. Under the governor's emergency executive order 2012, Department of Human Services was given temporary authority to waive or modify requirements. So currently there are 107 waivers that we are working under. Some of those waivers are not directly impacting our specific caseload, but they may be related to court hearings, eviction notices that do impact us, even though they're not directly impacting the caseload that we're serving. It's a broader range of impact. Majority of the waivers that are directly impact us, some of them are related to phone calls and video versus face-to-face times. We do have some extensions of paperwork that we can get in, and work requirements and extensions of recertification within the income maintenance world. We have seen a decrease in intakes, and I think I spoke of this early on in the pandemic, that we felt like that was probably what we were seeing, was that individuals were staying home, they weren't in the school systems, they weren't going to the doctors. And so in 2019, we had 670 intakes in the social service, so not income maintenance related, only social services. In 2020, we had 603. So we did have a decrease of 10% of intakes that were coming into us. We saw an increase in adult protection and adult services. We saw a decrease in child protection, adult mental health, and chemical dependency. A piece of that chemical dependency was due to the court systems being shut down. Specific to child protection intakes, so if I give you that number of 2019 of 670 social service intakes, 250 of them were directly related to child protection. In 2020, of those 603 intakes, 193 were directly related to child protection. So we have seen a decrease in the overall amount of intakes, but the concerning part is that we're seeing an increase in the severity of the child protection cases that we are managing. So we are often getting those intakes from law enforcement when previously would have maybe received an intake from a provider, whether it be in a clinic or in the school system. We're now seeing them from law enforcement and the extensive severity of those cases. So in regards to social services, a little bit more breaking it down. Currently we have 17 children that are in placement. 16 of those children are in the custody of the county. Our children's mental health workers are averaging around 13 cases, and the max is 15 cases that DHS recommends. Our adult mental health case managers are averaging around 12 cases. Our child protection cases are averaging around 13 cases. The recommendation is 7 to 10, but we have seen those numbers a lot higher than 13 in the past. But again, what we're seeing is the severity of those cases that has changed over the last year. A few of the trends: adult mental health and chemical dependency and increase in commitments. We've had 5 within the last 2 months and 3 within the last month, and there are years that we have that as a total or don't even meet that total. So we are seeing a significant increase of commitments in the adult mental health and chemical dependency world. With removals, with family and kinship placements, we're seeing an increase in child foster care licensing requests. We initially saw a decrease in court hearings, but now we're starting to see an increase in those chemical dependency assessments and court hearings involving those with chemical dependency issues. We're seeing an increase in intake calls for food and housing. We have seen an increase in removals from children in the past 2 months, specifically the primary release and reason being related to drugs. And we have had multiple removals over the past 2 weeks. Adult protection was at a pretty high number earlier in the summer, but that has kind of leveled out recently. Our income maintenance staff and those that we're serving in that field, we have 550 active SNAP, cash, and long-term cases. We have 644 MET cases with 1,444 active recipients receiving that. All of the caseloads have increased since the beginning of the pandemic last March, with the largest increase being with SNAP, which is roughly 10%, and METS cases, which is roughly 15% increase.
What's METS again?
It's through the system at the DHS level. So we work directly with the state level to provide that income support. So it's a little bit different than SNAP and general assistance. We have approximately 15 waivers that are currently in place in the income maintenance and child support and child care systems. In regards to the fiscal and their impact with the pandemic and 2019 versus 2020, there is a trend of less MA transportation rides as we're seeing more individuals are deferring their appointments till after the pandemic and or using telehealth. Besides that, that has been a minimal impact to the financial side of things. So it's just a very rough overview of each specific department and some of the numbers and the trends that we're seeing.
Thank you for that.
Thank you, Liberty. Anybody got anything for Liberty? Have a good day.
Hey, thank you.
Thank you. Jan, come on up.
Yes, I will. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My first item would be for the board to approve the resignation of our custodian, Steve Parsons, effective January 1st, and then approve the backfill of the position.
Motion to approve the resignation for Steve Parsons.
Second.
Had a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Motion to move forward with approving the backfill for that position.
Second.
Had a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Thank you.
So, have we, I haven't seen a posting for the vacancy in the assessor's office. Is there, has that not been posted yet?
Not yet. I'm meeting with my implementation coordinator this week, and we are planning on getting that position put online so that it can be, the new software that we purchased through the CARES Act, then the applicants actually apply online. So it was just a little patience. But yes, it's coming. The Human Services Department currently utilizes an informal on-call list of employee volunteers to check messages, emails, and faxes for child protection notifications after hours, which those calls then must be responded within a 24-hour period, the message being left. So, we're the two social worker supervisors and the director will rotate these duties because it's, the issue is best addressed in union negotiations on how that is going to look more formally. So for the interim period, those two social worker supervisors and the director are going to be working on answering those and responding to those calls and messages, and then setting up the intake team that's required for response. The informal system is going to remain in place for law enforcement calls. So when the volunteers will still respond to law enforcement calls. So we are proposing that in the interim, the two social worker supervisors and the director receive an augmentation to their 2021 wages. So we had budgeted $11,200 for this purpose. So then if we just divide that by three, that is the number we come up with, $3,733.33. And that's why I asked Liberty to be here so that she could maybe speak directly to more some of the questions you might have.
The challenge is you guys remember back when they had the mandates from the child protection case in a neighboring county that there be a 24/7 response on certain cases. And what we had done is try to roll over as many spot incoming things to dispatch, and then dispatch was kind of serving as an intermediary. Almost every county around us has gone to some sort of formal on-call system. And the reason why there's compensation tied to this is because they're engaged to wait. They can't go about their normal life activities when they're doing a few of these tasks. So, you know, to put some compensation with it is what's going to be expected when we go into negotiations and talk about it on a larger scale. But for right now, this recognizes extra duties that we're compensating these three to complete. And I think the reason why it kind of had an impetuous, or that was raised to that level, is because Liberty's unit has had a couple of close calls, and the frequency of these calls has increased. And so, you know, I know there's an example of maybe missing it by one or making it by 1 or 2 hours, catching the call on the Monday morning at 7 a.m. And so the challenge is if we don't follow those reporting requirements within that 24-hour period, it can come back to us in terms of kind of a write-up, so to speak, and ultimately could affect funding at some point if we're non-compliant with some of these tasks. So just so folks understand, the reports aren't coming just through dispatch. They come in through dispatch, they may be coming through the agency phone line, they may be coming through the fax, they might be coming through email, they might be coming through SSIS as a transfer from another county. or another agency. And so that's the risk there, is if it's one thing to roll that phone over and we can kind of do that fairly easily, but when we looked at the technology behind the SSIS piece and the fact we really couldn't find a way to leverage dispatch to help us out with those. And so we talked about this during budget time, I know with the board, about what the impact would be. We will have to have some further conversations with the union. I think my piece that Liberty and I talked a lot about is I'm concerned about it being another added duty for staff and for the supervisors. And that's concerning to me because they have been putting in a lot of hours. And those that do the 24/7 are the ones with the highest comp time. So I think that's a concern for me, is that it adds that burden to the workload. But for right now, this would get us by until we can have some conversations with the union this fall and see where that goes for a future plan. What else did I miss, Liberty?
No, I think you explained it fairly well.
If you have questions for Liberty or Jan or I, we did meet with the personnel committee and we talked about it there a couple of times. We're trying to find, there's a balance. We're trying to get the work done, but we're trying to find the most cost-effective way to get that work done.
We did also meet with the a labor law attorney to see if we can be creative in some of the responses, but that was her response to them, was the best way was to handle union negotiations. Otherwise, anything else we were looking at was a violation of Fair Labor Standards Act. So that's the route that we were advised to go.
So do you have to come in and check the SSIS?
So the supervisors and myself with technology, we will not. We will be able to do that through laptops that we have. And SSIS moved web-based maybe 2 years ago. If it wouldn't have been, then that would have been a different story. And then we will be able to roll the mainline number to us. We already receive all the faxes through our phones. And so then we'll be able to check the SSIS system too. And this will be for Saturdays, Sundays, and holidays. Through the week will still be our informal system, and on the weekends, the informal system with law enforcement if we do receive a call.
All right. I'd entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second.
I've got a motion and a second. Any more discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Our next item is System Merit System Liberty.
What can you say for Merit System too?
I'm not sure if we need okay. to.
You were looking at me like I need to say. I'm like, I'll just shut the door.
Stephens County is a part of the Minnesota Merit System, which was created to address hiring impractices and inconsistencies for the Human Services Department specifically. There is funding tied to it so that all the hiring practices must meet certain federal requirements. We were reviewing the cost now that has gone associated with the participation, and it is increasing quite significantly. So for 2021, it will be $11,500-ish per year, broken up into quarter payments. We feel that because we now have a human resources system and the hiring practices that meet state and federal requirements, and they're consistent, that this really is obsolete, and we don't feel that we're getting our money's worth basically for the $11,500 that we're expected to pay. I'm certainly not seeing, if they were doing things like a statewide hiring advertising, if they were doing background checks, things like that, that are time consuming and costly, I would, be seeing the value of it. We're not. So it does take one calendar year to get out of the system, and that is because then you're working with DHS to make sure that all those federal requirements are in place. So it is purposefully drawn out. So in order for us to meet the federal merit system requirements, the approval must occur then in order for the county to operate its own system. Let's see, I think have a list of the documents that are going to be reviewed by the certification process, including our personnel policies and rules, our procedures, job analysis, the selection process, our classification plan, position descriptions, our compensation plan, affirmative action plan, performance evaluations, and employee development and training plan. So most counties that were withdrawing from the merit system set their notification in by December 31st of 2020 in order to be out by January 1st of 2022. So if we start now and provide our notification, it would actually be January 1st of 2023 before we would be out. We weren't quite aware of that December 31st deadline when we first started looking at this. So we still feel that it's worth starting the process now in case it's lengthy, in case there's more work that we need to do and get implemented. We'll have the time to do that and budget for it if necessary. So I would ask for approval to send a formal notification letter to the Minnesota Merit System with their intention to withdraw. Does anybody have any questions about how the system works or?
I'll just add a little bit more anecdotally. So when I first started, I think we paid around $6,000 annually. And since then, we've seen a steady decline in the amount of counties that currently continue to use merit. I just felt like I wasn't, I didn't see the value added. I saw that it slowed the process down every time we used it, even back, you know, that far back in 14. But I think that the eye-opener for me is we've almost doubled what we pay merit in the last 7 years. So it goes up to $11,318 or almost. So they run a July to an end of June calendar year. And the challenge with that is we get like two different quarterly payments the first quarter and two different the second. By the end of the year, it'll be up $900 a quarter versus what it was last year. So the most significant increase we've seen has been in this last fiscal year going into 2021 for payments. So the rate of transfer of our share of the money has gone up substantially, like about 30% this coming year. And that's because there were six large agencies covering 1,000 employees that got out in 2020. There's another six that gave notification in December of 2020. And I didn't, like Jan said, I didn't realize that the notification, if it wasn't by December 30th, they could make you stay all of 2022. I'm hopeful that maybe we can, you know, get out mid-year or something. Maybe we can pay halfway through their fiscal year because it does give them enough time for planning. It really matters how quickly we can get through our documents and our process. So, I mean, they say they try to get you through in a year, but it could be longer than that. So either way, even if worst case scenario we pay in 2022, we're still going to be money ahead in the long run. I don't feel like I said before, I think their processes slow our hiring process down by 2 to 4 weeks, depending on the position. And they're not doing any value added like the advertising. All that costs is still on us. All the work that Jan does to post a position is still all on us. Another piece of the pie too is now we have NeoGov, which is what they use to post positions through merit system. And so kind of everything that they're doing, we're already doing, and we're probably doing to a further extent than what they're performing. So I think that the commissioners should support this. We talked about this at the personnel committee. Human services doesn't really touch the system other than as an applicant. You know, a lot of times Jan's redirecting an applicant to go back to merit and say, you know, I can't qualify you until you apply through merit. I feel like in my recent memory, every position that we've advertised has come through one of our traditional advertising mechanisms that we employ, and then we're sending them back to merit. It's not like they're in merit and they're getting a reference to come here. It very rarely happens that way. Yeah. I feel like that's fair, that everybody that we've hired has come through our online advertising or our newspaper ad.
And a very high percentage of those people would be local individuals.
Yeah. So I feel like, you know, not only are we paying for an HR department's wage and all the advertising that we do, that ends up being about $1,500 per applicant. Besides that, we're paying almost another $11,500. So it's not, you know, huge money, but I do think our share of that's gonna continue to grow. Merit has responded by like not backfilling some positions as people have retired there, and they do have a new director. It used to be Betty for the longest time, and now this new Jessica has been much more approachable and easy to work with and trying to change, but I don't think that we can afford to stay in it if that pace of increase of our dues continues.
Well, we've talked about getting on a merit system for a long time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think make that
served
motion.
It served its purpose very well when it needed to.
Yep. I would make that a motion.
I'll second it.
I have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? Hearing none, I'll call the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Okay, and then my final item is the fee equity compliance report. Every 3 years, we must submit a report to the state. I put this together, and it does need to be approved and submitted by January 31st. So if you want to look at the data, we put in the minimum maximum salaries for each position and classifying how many males and females are in each position, and then the years to the maximum, that would be when they would get step 11 and then longevity. So after putting all those that information in, to my dismay, my first the first hit of the button for analysis came up that we were under compliance. We were not in compliance. So we went back and we were looking at the data and realized just how much had changed in the last 3 years as far as the number of new employees that we've hired over since this first last report was done. So therefore they're not getting longevity. And some of the actual classifications have changed as far as the male-female ratios. We used to have a couple of classes that had both. Now they're all one or all other. So it kind of, it can skew the data a little bit. So we had the ability to do a manual test, which actually helped me through. It's called a T-test. And we were able then to pass because the statistics were, inadequate, but too close.
The variation isn't significant enough to be a statistical significance.
Yeah.
So yeah. It was we're looking for zero or looking for 80% or higher, and it was a 75.6 roughly is what the compliance was. So it wasn't a high enough variance to make that fail. Mm-hmm. So you had to look at the variance, then you had to go to a table, and if you were in compliance with that it was fine. But what you're seeing directly there is you're seeing what happened with the data, and Jan's spot on, is that we had a lot of, eligibility workers in some of those positions churn, and so they were starting lower on the pay scale, and they didn't have the seniority to get the longevity pay. So that's what was driving that down just below 80%. So
if you look at section 3, the salary range test itself, we passed with 93.68%. But it's that exceptional service pay test and the analysis report that came in under.
The statistical analysis, it doesn't show that they're, in our case, it doesn't show that they're paid lower than their male counterparts. It shows that we have a lot more brand new people starting lower on the wage grade steps.
So it intended to be that we hired more women over this past 5 years, and that the men were already here, established, and receiving longevity pay if they were eligible for it. So, but we should be okay. I will, if I can submit the report, then we will wait to hear from the state. They'll send a compliance notification, which requires to be posted then. If they find an issue with it, then I may need to come back for some fix for it.
You need a motion on that, correct?
Yes, I do have to have this approved as I've submitted it so I can send it to the state.
Motion approved.
Second. I have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
I can have
have you, it says chief elected official. Thank you. And I think that's all I had.
All right. Well, thank you, Jan.
Thank you.
Steph, come on up.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Is there any questions on the auditor warrants?
I have a question on page 8, 113, page 2. On the bottom, the state of Minnesota, that what's CRF?
So that is the CARES money that we received back from the city of Morris that we had to pay back to the state.
Okay.
Yep.
That's pretty good to only have to pay that much back.
Well, as of right now.
So the, and I'll tell you that there's, you'll see a few more allocations coming. What happened was, is as, so if they, cities were supposed to remit their money before December 1st so the county could spend it. We actually have incurred that cost, but we couldn't keep it because it was returned after the date, and we became the entity that had to remit payment back to the state as opposed to the cities. But there's a couple of grants that were in the process of auditing, and when we find that they didn't spend the grant in compliant things, then that money will come back to the county, and the county can't keep that funds even though we have that cost because it's past the date.
Okay.
So we'll end up with another couple of payments here coming back in the next probably 2 to 3 weeks is what we're thinking.
Okay. And then we're just going to hold those until we got them all and then
try to get one more back.
Yeah, one more payment back. Is there any other questions? The auditor warrants? Okay. We'll move to the commissioner warrants.
I will just tell you guys that I had one question for staff, and I have a question into Jason. I haven't gotten an answer. It's on that Motorola payment that's on 114 payday. Oh gosh, it's on page. So it's the payment, I think, for the dispatch console. And if you remember when we signed that agreement, we asked if we could prepay because that fund balance was running so high. And if we prepaid multiple years, they were going to give us a discount. But I see it's only 1 year that came through.
Yep, and I checked the invoice, and it is only 1 year. It's from November of 20 through October 31st of 21.
So I think we probably should go ahead and pay it, but I'm still going to have a conversation with Jason because I you know, part of the audit on that 911 fund, too, is spending that money that we get. And so if we've been carrying a large balance because we knew there was going to be some transition of the dispatch equipment, and I guess if there is some value to be had in a multiple year payment, I would like to try to realize that. Even, I mean, 3% still would be worth it.
So we've decided that it is for the dispatch, it's not for radios?
Well, if it's for a year, it's got to be, yeah.
Okay, okay.
Because it came from 2290, which is the E911.
Yeah.
That was my other thing. I'm sure this was for... Oh, what page? Oh.
Yeah.
It would be page 6 of the 114 commissioner's warrants.
See, and Lori wrote on here radios. She wrote on her annual service dues, and then she put slash radios.
Maybe we haven't seen that. Okay.
But it's out of 290. It is. So maybe we need to get clarification.
It says annual service on
here. Yep, annual service dues. And she wrote radios.
Well, we will follow up on that. If it's radios, then that... Okay.
Yeah, and on the invoice, it doesn't say...
Okay.
No, it just says service from November 2020.
So we'll be clarifying.
You'll find out about that?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Yes. Any other questions?
I need a motion to approve the commissioner warrants.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? Hearing none, I'll call the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Okay. We'll move on to the ditch loan advancements. County Ditch 5 needs a loan of $4,500 to cover the shortages from December. With this advance, the current balance is $118,400. So I need a motion to approve a loan advance from County Ditch 18 to County Ditch 5 in the amount of $4,500.
So moved.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
County Ditch 25 needs a loan of $6,500 to cover the shortages from December. With this advance, the current balance is $245,500. I need a motion to approve loan advance from County Ditch 18 to County Ditch 25 in the amount of $6,500.
So moved.
Second. Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Okay. And then in your packet was the year-end or the quarterly ditch balances for the fourth quarter. Is there any questions on those balances? Okay. So you have the paperwork for pay request number 4 for County Ditch 18. I visited with Scott and they are out today doing the hammering of the system, and they actually hammered the most footage that they've ever had yesterday. So it's going real well. Things are looking good. They should finish up tomorrow on the hammering. So that is good. So if there's no questions on the pay requests, I need a motion to approve that. And that payment will be made tomorrow.
I'll make the motion for pay request. $32,819.46.
Second.
Brandon Brothers. I got a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Okay. In your packet is findings in order for a public hearing for County Ditch 5. So this is an order that needs to be approved to move forward to have the public hearing for the improvement of County Ditch 5 and the redetermination of County Ditch 5. The findings just go through that we received the petition on May 7th of 2019. That we appointed Chuck Brandle with ISG to be the engineer. Once we received the preliminary survey report, I filed that and we had a preliminary hearing, and that hearing was approved and accepted on February 4th. Then you guys adopted the findings and orders initiating the redetermination of benefits for County Ditch 5 and appointed H2 overviewers to do the redetermination of the benefits. The detailed survey report was filed with the Auditor Treasurer's Office, and the viewer's report was filed, and also the benefits and damage statements were sent out to landowners for County Ditch 5. So the order is just saying that we would like to proceed with the final hearing, and that the final hearing will be February 16th of 21 at 5:30 at the old number 1 South Side, 412 Atlantic Avenue in Morris. Kale had left me a voice message. I have a Microsoft Teams link from ISG, but he's wondering also if we should possibly do a Zoom link. He's not sure if everyone is real familiar with Microsoft Teams. That's what ISG
so
provides.
Teams is difficult because people have to sign up for a free account if they don't have a Microsoft Outlook. I think, but if you have two different softwares going, you're going to get conflict and you're going to get echoing. So I think we need to go with one software.
Okay.
And I would recommend they do Zoom.
You would recommend we do Zoom.
Because that's much easier for the general public to join.
So then I think what we'll do is we'll set up the Zoom link, Becky. Is that
okay?
Is that okay? Because that is, it's just not what ISG uses as Zoom. They use the Microsoft Teams.
Yep.
How did it go for the landowner meeting? I, of course, was not able to be there. And I know they use Microsoft Teams, I think, at that time, didn't we? Or did we set up the Zoom link?
No, he used Teams. I'm trying to remember. I think he used Teams, but I don't know that anybody logged in that wasn't Stevens County.
Okay.
Because, you know, if you are on Teams already, it's super easy, and the audio can actually be a little bit better. But if you do not have that Microsoft account, your option is to download that and do a free account temporarily or only call in. Well, I think you lose someone, you don't have the visual.
Right.
And being this is a final hearing, we might get more attendance. But what I could do is I could actually give the hosting, like I could call the meeting to order into the Zoom and then give him the hosting.
Okay.
So he'll log on as a guest, then he'll take control as the host.
Okay. Okay. And that's fine. And I can contact Jacob and let him know that we would rather do it virtually through Zoom.
I've got two things. One, just for the public's information, the reason it's at the old number on south side is spacing requirement for the meeting. And then the other thing, do I have to abstain from voting where the meeting is held?
No, staff selected that. You'd be motioning to set the final hearing date.
Yeah, this is just to move forward to approve the findings in order to move forward to have the final hearing.
Okay. So this order says the courthouse county boardroom.
That's what's
good. Looks like it was highlighted and it never maybe got changed.
Oh no, on mine I have it. It's changed. On the order A, I have that it's going to be held on February 16, 2021 at 5:30 at the old number one south side. So when we put the notice together, we will mail the property owners, we will post it on the courthouse door here, and yes, it'll be notified that it's at the old number one south side due to the space.
Yep. Does it have to note that there's a virtual option too in the findings and order?
Yes. In the findings and order, but on the final hearing notice, it will be noted.
They'll be noted. Okay.
Yes. Yes. Yep.
Okay. Can I entertain a motion?
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any more discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Okay. We have the same thing for County Ditch 25. Going through the same section, County Ditch 25. This order for the final hearing is for the petition for the establishment of Branch 5, Fork 2, the lateral to County Ditch 25, and in the matter of the redetermination and also the improvement of County Ditch 25. This one, the final hearing, will start at 7 o'clock at the old number one south side.
And ours says the courthouse again.
Yeah, yeah. Those were just templates. So
moved. Second. Got a motion and a second. Any more discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carried.
Perfect. Thank you.
Bill, come on up.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, Bill.
Good morning. I'm on the agenda for the county board consideration to adopt and implement the Boyd and Mistinka Comprehensive Watershed Management Plan. The policy committee submitted the plan for state comments back on December 15th. Once all the comments received were addressed, the plan was then presented to the Bowser North Regional Committee on January 6th. That committee will be recommending the plan for approval by the full Bowser Board on January 27th at their monthly meeting. I want to note the resolution that you have for consideration indicates adopting contingent upon to the Bowser Board approval at that meeting. And my understanding for the reasoning of that is we need to get the plan approved and on its way so we can get the $1.1 million allocated towards the county for doing that. So, and I believe it's by the 1st of March or something.
Everything's got to be done by the 1st of March.
Yeah,
otherwise, we're going to lose that $1.1 million, supposedly. That's what we've been told.
So with that, I guess I'm recommending approval of this adoption. Are there any questions?
Got a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. I think we're... Thank you, Becky.
Okay. Just a couple of quick things. And I should have, and when we're done, if you don't mind, I'll just give you a quick update on the new business relief application process too. I should have put that on here just for a general update. So we have a budget adjustment, and what happened here is that when we met in the summer of 2020, we didn't know if SWCD was going to be guaranteed that capacity funding that we had, that the board had funded the last couple of years. So it was, if we increased the funding that we gave, they could get up to a certain max. It was 14.4. So it wasn't listed as an expense in 2-706-6815, which is our restricted fund, like we've done in years past. So in years past, we actually listed a list of expenses and then showed them an approved budget. So while it doesn't affect the levy, it still wasn't approved with that as a delineated expense. So I'm just looking for a budget adjustment to reflect that fact. We did confirm that they will be getting that capacity funding if it's granted from the county. So we just need to adjust 2-706-6815 to actually show that 14.4 in capacity funding to SWCD. Additionally, I just want to remind us all of the conversation, because it was like we did budgeting and then we went into CARES Act and we didn't talk about budgeting again. So it was kind of a whirlwind of a fall. They had asked just for a blanket $25,000 for buffer enforcement spending. And I think the board's conversation, if I recall right, was that that you would consider giving additional funding out of those buffer monies that were restricted, but it was going to be on a bill basis versus a blanket $25,000. So we may see invoices coming back and they would be paid out of that restricted fund, but we only pay them as we incurred them. So that if everybody just, I just wanted to refresh everybody's memory. So if you look at the attachment, let me just get it and pull it up here. So this is what it would look like. It's just a, just showing a spend down to that 14.4 from that restricted fund. So I just needed a motion to approve that. Or take any questions.
I'll make the motion to approve budget adjustment of $14,400.
I'll second.
We had a motion and second. Any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Okay, thank you. And then Aaron is on. I don't know if Aaron or Neil want to present this next one here. It was just a wage change for the law library. If Aaron or Neil have anything they want to add on that. Oh, I didn't put them out. Wait, I did.
Oh, did.
It's going to $80. I see they put it in that motion below there.
I believe it was 50 before.
Yes, correct. Yeah.
It's basically to cover her time.
Yeah.
The judge felt that it was more than due that she should be paid more. So.
And it's to update the law library, correct?
Right.
The duties correct. Of that.
Yeah. Keep it organized, and there's a bunch of different little duties that she does. So.
I'll move to approve that.
I'll second.
And a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
I'll just give a brief update on that CARES Act stuff. So, well, not CARES Act, sorry, state funding. There's a, just so you all are aware, we are in the process of that federal single audit. And so far, they really liked what the board's elected to put together for our policy and all that. But we're also auditing folks that have received CARES Act money. And that expenses were supposed to be into us, you know, within 60 days of their last awards, the end of December. So Pam and I have been working every week to send reminders and to try to collect data from folks. Some's been very easy, some's been a little bit difficult. But I am getting to the point that if we don't get expenses collected, that the county will shortly issue a letter here within a week saying that we want those funds paid back. Because we are in the minute, we need to, if the date's already passed, we need to have that information on file. I had Steph re-clarify with the auditors on Friday, but they are looking for the actual expense reports. We're justified in what we're asking for. They are a subrecipient grantee under the federal uniform grant guidance. So we are the original grantee. We didn't spend the money, we passed it on. Now they've got to provide proof that those were actual expenses that were permitted under the Federal CARES Act. So,
and they knew that when they got the grant?
It was in the application. Yeah. It was told to them when they got the grant agreement. So it's been told three times, and then we have sent reminders repeatedly. So they were told that, and I won't do anything until I tell the board that I'm going to proceed with sending out that kind of final letter. My next step is to make actual phone calls this week and try to get those cleaned up. We got a ton of information last week. Some people were very responsive and got that, forgot the timeline, you know, got into the busy holiday season, had a lot of stuff going on. So that's explainable. But now we're at the point where we do need to clear up those last probably like 8 files and get them completed. So I will let the board know before we send anything out. The next round of grant funding is the state round. I'm just going to kind of give you guys, I know you understand the three buckets of money. I know you understand that DOR is giving their money. DOR's money was supposed to be out at the beginning of January. When I talked to folks last week about what they could expect and when, reminder that DOR wouldn't tell us what they were giving people. So there was a lot of misunderstanding. They sent notification through their e-services portal. Well, a lot of businesses have an accountant that maybe does that or whatever. So they were really uncertain that they were even expecting money. It was supposed to be out by early January. Last week on the 11th, when I was working through the issue, they still hadn't gotten funding out, although they were supposed to be mailing checks out that week. Now, I don't know if people have actually gotten things, but the important thing here to notice is that if businesses don't file quarterly, they file semi-annually or annually, they might have been missed in Department of Revenue's calculations for the amount of money that they should have coming, and they all have to do a manual application. So I've been trying to get that information out through business owners that have asked questions and through the chamber and through the economic development director as well. So we have a real challenge here is we don't know what people are supposed to be getting or what they will or won't get, but we do know that there's people who haven't received it and they might have to do a manual process. So I'm just trying to educate the public that they know that they may have to dig a little bit deeper in to get that money. And that bucket of money was for those businesses that were closed under Executive Order 103. That was the most recent closure. So I just encouraging businesses as much as we possibly can to make sure that they're checking their communications through Department of Revenue and looking for that funding. That was supposed to be the fastest bucket of money that got out, and that's kind of trickling out this week, I would assume. So our application is online. It's gone out to the chamber. It's gone out through economic development, through all those listservs. We have it on the website. I put it on Facebook once. I'll probably try to repost it again a few times. And then you guys are the best source of communication to get that application out. It closes the 27th, so next week at 4 p.m. on the 27th. And we just really need folks to take a look at that and make sure they get that paperwork in. It's much less burdensome than the first application. There's not as many requirements because it's not federal money. The state left it very open. So just encouraging people to get that done as soon as they possibly can. But it's a little bit difficult to complete it because they don't know what they're even getting from DOR yet. So they don't really know what to ask for. So I think that's why we haven't seen a large amount of applications yet. So as much as you can, just encourage people to look at that, make sure they're getting stuff in. The priorities are those that have been most heavily impacted by closures due to executive orders is how the priority for the funding should be granted. So any questions on that? Otherwise, that's all I have.
Any commissioner reports?
We had the Historical Society. There's a new exhibit up at the museum, and it's on bands around Stevens County, so it's pretty interesting. And they got some money from a person, and they bought these kiosks, so they really can add to their exhibits. It's pretty cool. And our gift shop is now online, so you can look at the...
For the museum?
For the museum, yep.
Okay. The Law Library Committee met, and Becky, I have a question for you. One of the things that our state law librarian suggested, I think she did the previous year too, is that there be signs for the law library.
Okay.
I don't know if you've never heard of it. Must have fell through the cracks last time, so
okay.
she would like to see that done so people are aware of it. And I think they're going to try and put some more things out there that to make people not aware that it is available.
I'll check and see if it's on the directory. I think the challenge is, as you guys have noted us too, when you come in the building, people just put up whatever they want and it's all over, and so it doesn't really draw attention to it. So we've been trying to keep it limited to the directory so that people go there and look, but I'll follow up and make sure that it gets added if it's not on there, so.
All right. Anything else?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.